today is I would go in and I would speak to her. She'd open her eyes. They began to bring her out of the coma. And I would go in as much as I could and see her. And finally, when she opened her eyes, I sang to her another song. Jeepers Creepers. Take a look at them creepers. The hardest part of the third surgery was she had to go in for procedures every 2 days. Monday, Wednesday, Friday. Under general anesthesia because she had an open abdomen. The head was called a wound back on there to pull out all the materials that were accumulated so that she wouldn't be infected. She had over 35 procedures, all surgeries under general anesthesia. She's able to speak, able to think. They're now finding that ICU patients, a large percentage of them, go home with dementia from that point forward because of what they've experienced in ICU. My wife was not in ICU once, or twice, or three times, or four times. I believe it was six or seven during her illness of 2.5 years. Twice in a medical release from three times. Third surgery was in March. In April, I was so depressed. We were living with CISA when this happened. So here I didn't have my wife. I had one room upstairs in the bathroom, and that was my home. And I spent 12, 14 hours a day with my wife in the hospital advocating for her. There are reasons why you advocate for one so ill. She asked me to go get a book, so I went to get the book about traveling life. And I went to the bookstore. The computer said they don't have it. I looked on the shelves, it wasn't there. It's a book on Psalms 23. If you haven't read it, I suggest you do. I was so depressed. I asked the man at the counter, I said, can you help me find this book? He said, yes. He looked it up. The computer said, we don't have it. We did it in 24 hours. He said, let's go look up and down the road. So we looked up one row, down the next row, and up in this row. And honestly, it looks like we don't have it. That's okay. Can we order it? He said, sure, let's go back to my station and order it. So we started back up the road, and there was a tall woman standing there, and all I remember is she had on blue jeans and a black t-shirt. And as we started to walk by her, she stuck out her hand with a book, and she says, is this the book you're looking for? I took the book, traveling one. Thank you. She's walking on it. She's got her boots in her hand. And she is walking really fast. And I thought, who is this person? So I started to follow, and something said, don't do that. So I didn't. But I went back the next day because I saw her just go around this corner really quickly. So the next day I went back to that bookstore and I went and I looked around that corner because I thought it was an exit. Because that person did not slow down. They just hit a wall there.
Wow.
We read that book. chapter by chapter, every day at the hospital. That book was made just for me. And as we read it, there was a nurse who came in one day. And when we got, she got on the computer and she didn't leave. She didn't leave. She didn't leave. And when we finished the chapter, she turned around with tears in her eyes. And she said, "You have no idea how much I needed to hear that." That book wasn't just for me. That book was for someone else too. God isn't just for you. God is through your life for someone else.
Amen.
This experience didn't happen just to us. It was so that we could share in the experience of others who are going through a very similar thing. We had a house for sale for 2 years in the Walla Walla Valley. Hadn't sold, hadn't sold, hadn't sold. So every month I would take a week to go over to Walla Walla, clean up the house, the inside, the outside, so it would look more sellable. The house didn't sell, the house didn't sell, and finally we decided we would raise the price of the house $15,000. Because we decided we were going to go back there and live when we got out of the hospital. Funny thing about God. He's very mysterious. I don't understand why he does it. But he likes to see you come up against the wall. And when you come up against the wall, then he says, "Shout!" And the wall comes tumbling down. One thing happened before we go forward here, and that was in May. I woke up early one morning and I'm hearing, "Go, get up, get up, get up, go to the hospital, go to the hospital, get up, go to the hospital." It's 2 hours before I'm supposed to go to the hospital. Okay. So I quickly got on my clothes. Let me tell you folks, if the Holy Spirit talks to you, don't shut it out. If you have an urging to do something, do it. I got to the hospital around 8:20. When I walked in my wife's room, I found her in convulsions, unresponsive, overmedicated, a temperature of 104.5, and not in her sight.